Now it's the big one. You know what we're about to talk about. We can't do an episode about airports without
talking about Los Angeles Airport. One that builds the most traffic.
The one that has stopped up the whole city. The reason you're late to work every day is because of this airport.
When someone says you need to go to this place, people are like, oh, what?
It's the reason I never leave town. So attention, passengers. Now boarding all groups for the nonstop flight to History Town. Duration of flight, however long it takes you to lose interest and turn on My Favorite Murder instead.
What I like is that when I title the episode, you're like, this is dumb. But then every sentence of a story is like, well,
I'm world building.
You like work like a James Joyce novel into your first sentence to talk about.
And you want to read my James Joyce letters?
To talk about. We're going to save the James Joyce illusions for when we talk about the gas company.
Don't you just love the smell of an oil field at first light? Which is a lyric from U2 almost, who is also Irish. In the 1920s, Los Angeles had no municipal airport until Glendale came along, but that was for Glendale. And that was a little bit later. So there was the one in Burbank and Glendale, and there were a bunch of airfields, just small things like Dominguez Field, where Cal State Dominguez Hills now is. Yeah. They hosted the first air show in the United States.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and they were also the location of one of the first bombing experiments where they dropped sandbags from an airplane on a target.
We make fun of how kind of old-timey that is. I bet that hurt. That would kill someone.
Yeah, it would. And they were also, they were also explosive.
Here's, a list of all the people that died in that. What year was this where they had all this stuff?
This was just early 1910s, early 1920s.
Okay. A lot of sand at that time.
The sandy days. There was Rogers Airport at Wilshire and Fairfax, which we talked about with Amelia Earhart. That's where she first went up in the air.
Glendale,
like 20 years later. When she was professional, that was the first time. There was the Griffith Park Aerodrome. Did you know about that?
No.
It was on the northeast corner of the park, which is kind of like across the river from the Glendale Airport.
Where the zoo is? Or what?
Yeah, pretty much where the zoo was.
That's why the lion was in the plane.
Yeah, they had to get him back to work. There was the Van Nuys Airport also, but these were privately owned airfields. Lions welcome. BYOL. There wasn't one that was city-owned for the Los Angeles City to be of service to the city. So then in 1927, Charles Lindbergh racial slurred his way across the Atlantic and on his
Jules.
He just screamed that into the tank before fueling up. After that, he went on a publicity tour and he gave a talk in LA at the Coliseum in front of a crowd of 60,000 people who came out to listen to a pilot give a speech.
Are you gonna do a Lindy Hop or what?
Do it for
do
us.
Do it for America.
Well, okay. I do. Again, that's what people, you know, what else are you going to do in that time? Basically, in this speech, he scolded the city for not having a municipal airport.
Sounds like.
And he said, and I know who's responsible for it. Where's my gas tank? He opens it at So he told them if they wanted to keep up with the rest of the country, they had to change that. So the same year, a group of concerned citizens led by Harry Culver City, they pushed the city to establish an airport, and the city knew it was the right thing to do to attract more business and visitors into the city. But the question was, where are we going to put this thing?
Henry Huntington's yard.
We've defeated him. He's a broken man.
He's a broken man now. It'll mock his trains.
Put him right next to him so that, for comparison. So 27 airports competed to win that title, but an early idea was that there would actually be three main airports that would service the city, which kind of makes sense. One would be in the valley at a place called Cessnon Field, which I'm not sure what it was. There's a Cessnon Street on the north part of Porter Ranch in Granada Hills, so I'm guessing it's somewhere around that area. Kind of near where Smokey Robinson lives.
Oh, and we saw Smokey Robinson that night.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I know that area.
That night and every night afterwards. So that was one of them. One was going to be at Vale Field in Montebello, around Vale Avenue, kind of near where the Citadel is.
Okay.
And then the third would have been at a small airfield in Westchester, kind of near the ocean. But this idea was insane. So the
city... Boats are for the ocean.
That's boat town. They're not going to like that. The sailors aren't going to like that. The city decided it had to choose just one. So the little airfield in Westchester was plucked from obscurity and sentenced to a lack of obscurity forever. But the airfield in Westchester took a long time to become what it is now. And this is where the history begins.
I'm so excited, and I just can't hide it.
After the Spanish left the country...
Oh, my God.
You gotta go back.
Oh, my God. You're talking about the wine that's developed from the grapes that were brought here that a pilot's gonna get drunk on, aren't you?
It all begins with the sunlight created 4 billion years ago.
Mountains form. The moon. Ocean recedes.
And then comes back and left some goo, and that's where Westchester came from. So the Spanish left the country. Lots of land was for grab. So Francisco Avila quickly grabbed that land in the area. And eventually in 1837, the governor, you're going to like this story. I know it goes back. You're going to like this.
No, I'm just kidding.
Well, don't.
That's not what this podcast is for.
Not a comedy podcast.
It's more of a movie reference podcast.
In 1837, the governor officially gave this land to him. He had stolen it for long enough, so now it was legally his. And he named it Rancho Salsa Redondo. But this area of land was huge, and the way he got it was questionable. So a guy named Ignacio Machado started squatting on the northern part of this land, and he stayed there long enough that in 1844, Governor Manuel Mitchell Turina figured what he was doing was illegal for long enough, so he's legal now. So he got part of that land. So he was officially given that part of the area, and he named it Rancho Aguaje de la Sentinela, or Ranch Sentinel of the Waters.
Okay.
He had built a house there a decade earlier in 1834 that is now known as the Sentinela Adobe. It's still there, right off the 405, a little up the road from Randy's.
Oh, okay.
He built
the donut.
The donut was part of the house. It was a Buñuelo back then. Giant Buñuelo.
I mean, it was the crazy time. That's how you got cars to stop when they were going down the highway.
That horse has got to pull over. And then when America took over, they punched the middle out so it became a donut. This is America. So obviously the Avilas didn't like this. So in 1845, Bruna Avila cut a deal with Machado to give him a house in the Pueblo downtown in exchange for the land he was squatting on and also 40 gallons of brandy. So the sucker that he was, he agreed. And now the Avila family owned all that land that was originally legally theirs after they had taken it from the Spanish illegally, who had taken it from the natives. Also illegally.
Although there were no laws at the time, unethically.
It was still illegal. It went from unethical to illegal. To legal. That's how it worked. That's how America was formed.
Sometimes you can just build a house and wait to see if anyone kicks you out.
Let's wait 300 years. So Bruno tried to run a cattle ranch off of his part of the land, but when the United States took over the land just a few years after this, he found he couldn't keep up with the American way of doing business, which was...
Was not brandy.
Yeah, which was no Mexicans allowed. And by 1857, he was completely bankrupt and horribly in debt. So the sheriff seized control of the land and auctioned it off to someone named Hilliard P. Dorsey, who got it for $2,000. This guy was the register of the U.S. Land Commission Office of Los Angeles, and he was also the founder of the city's first Masonic Lodge and their first worshipful master.
All creepy.
He was also a nasty gunslinger with a horrible reputation.
Go on, please.
He was fond of taking part in duels, and he kept notches on his gun of all the men he's killed. He didn't own the land for long because in 1858, his son and wife, whose name, her name was Civility Rubbottom.
You're making that up to make me laugh.
My name is Goody Buttfart. The son and wife, they fled to her parents' house because Dorsey was abusive.
Oh, the Rubbottoms.
The Rubbottom. Mother and son Rubbottom went to father Rubbottom because Hilliard P. Dorsey was abusing them.
Yeah.
So he went to her parents' house to get them back. But Father Rubbottom was waiting on the porch with a shotgun. And when Dorsey showed up, Father Rubbottom said, "Come no further." So Dorsey came further. And as he was walking up, he took out a gun to toss to his father-in-law to duel with him.
Mm-hmm.
They were going to duel to the death, son and father-in-law. And as he threw the gun to him, Father Rubbottom shot him dead with the shotgun.
That's what you do. And that's how you win a duel.
Yep.
Shoot them when they're offering to have a duel.
So now the rancho was the property of Civility Rubbottom, but she sold it for $630 to Francis J. Carpenter, who was not a carpenter, but rather the city jailer, who then sold it for $3,000 to a much more interesting person named Joseph Lancaster Brent. Brent was a land lawyer who had come to LA in 1850 from Maryland on a windjammer around Tierra del Fuego all the way up South America to Los Angeles.
What's a windjammer?
You know the boats that the pirates come in the third Lord of the Rings movie, but then all of the like ghosts come out of it?
Oh, yeah.
Those old ships with like big pointy sails.
Oh,
that's a windjammer.
Wow.
He had with him on one of these boats an army of the damned.
At his disposal.
Please release us. No, I want this ranch. He came with a bunch of books that would become the city's first law library.
Wow.
And he lived at the Pueblo next door to the famous Lugo family and made a name for himself as the land lawyer for pretty much every famous early LA family you can think of. The Dominguezes, the Verdugos, the Yorbas of Yorba Lindo, Pio Pico, and the Lugos themselves, who he seemed to be in their pocket because he once got the Lugo grandsons off the hook for murder and got a huge paycheck out of that.
It was made of brandy, though.
Everything was made of brandy.
Yeah, most things were just paid in brandy.
Eventually, he became the land lawyer for the Pueblo itself and then went on to become state school commissioner. And then in 1855, was elected to the state assembly. And he was said to be instrumental in helping get both Franklin Pierce and James Buchanan elected president of the United States with the influence he had in California.
That's crazy.
So when the Civil War hit...
Oh, you haven't brought up the Civil War, have you?
The American Infinity War, sorry.
American Infinity War.
He was approached by the Knights of the Golden Circle.
Oh!
Do you know who that, you know them?
No, all those words are like, well, the Knights Templar came and visited him.
Well, the Illuminati came to fight this army of the damned that came from Maryland. The Knights of the Golden Circle were this really racist group who wanted to convince parts of the United States and Mexico to create their own country based on slavery. So they were going to break off, while the Civil War was happening, they're like, hey, let's break off and have our own slave system here.
That's not what they're fighting about over there, is it? Oh, it is. Oh, then let's just join the South.
No, they wanted to be separate of that and have, like, worse slavery than that. Like, I don't know. Yeah, worse slavery than slavery.
Yeah, worse slavery than slavery. It's just kind of still slavery, though.
So they approached him and tried to get him, like, use your influence so we can create this new slave state. And he wanted to get California to secede from the United States. And to his credit, he refused them. But at the same time, he was a Confederate sympathizer. And soon after this, he left Los Angeles and the wonderful ranch he was on to go help the South. But he was arrested for disloyalty to the Union, but then President Lincoln personally ordered him to be released. And then, supposedly after this, he immediately went back to New Orleans and joined the rebels again and worked his way up to becoming an aide to Robert E. Lee. And again, supposedly, he was at Robert E. Lee's side when he surrendered to Grant at Appomattox Courthouse.
Wow.
So the former owner of the land LAX was on was at Appomattox Courthouse on the losing side. It's
That's
ridiculous.
Crazy.
Brent was long out of the picture.
God.
So back in 1860, the land was bought for $3,000 by yet another person you wouldn't expect to have a ranch in Los Angeles, a Scottish lord named Sir Robert Burnett. He was a baron of Craith's Castle in Bankery, Scotland, and he was on tour in California, and he loved it so much that he wanted to live here.
Is this just like a, it's sort of like a board game where the board's always the same, but it's like a different, like it's a shoe this time, and next time it's going to be like an airplane, and this time it's like a pipe.
It's like we're playing Life, but with the cast of Clue. He came to LA, he's like, I like this. And in 1868, he also bought the Rancho below that ranch.
Okay.
You know, there was the two that split off, the old Rancho Salso, the double ranchos.
Lord of the Rings, two ranchos.
So that was Rancho Salso Redondo. So he bought that for $30,000 and combined the two into one mega ranch that stretched 25,000 acres called Rancho Sentinella. But in 1873, royal duty called when his brother died and he had to return to Scotland to take over his castle. So he leased the ranch to yet another person you wouldn't expect, a wealthy Canadian lawyer named Daniel Freeman for $7,500 a year. Freeman came to LA because his wife had TB and they thought the fresh air would help her. It didn't. Oh. She died a year later. But Freeman stayed there and tried to raise sheep. But the same year his wife died, a drought hit that lasted for 2 years and killed 22,000 of his sheep.
What year was that?
1873.
Okay.
He lost most of his sheep, so he decided to switch to raising barley, and this actually was successful in 1882.
Wait, there was a drought?
There was a drought that killed all of his sheep.
But then he was able to raise, oh, because barley doesn't need it.
I guess, I'm sure it takes less water to raise 22,000. Sheep.
That's true.
Sheep are the thirstiest of animals.
We all know this. Fact. Yeah, we all know this, that they consume more water than fish do.
Behind fish, they're the most thirsty of all the animals. Water. So this, it was a success, and in 1882, he bought part of the land from the old Scottish lord for $22,243, and then the rest in 1885 for $140,000. But just 2 years later, he sold 11,000 of the acres to a land company that would go on to use that land to start the town of Inglewood. So it started getting sold off in chunks.
Okay, like subdivisions are created from
pretty branches. Much. Yeah. Some of it got sold. People were using it to grow wheat and lima beans. Then in 1894, he leased 2,000 acres to a man named Andrew B. Bennett, who turned that land into Rancho Bennett, who a few years later, when this sort of thing was invented, decided to set up a makeshift landing strip for local pilots to use. So the novelty of this brand new invention of flying humans started attracting onlookers to watch the planes go up and down, and pretty soon it became a hot weekend destination. Go to Rancho Bennett, watch the planes.
Now we go to that In-N-Out by LAX and watch them.
In and out of the atmosphere.
Yeah.
By 1920, they were even holding annual air races there that lasted until 1949 with all the changes that this place went to. And this popularity is what brought the land to the attention of the city council looking up a new municipal airfield. And this is the location they ended up choosing on September 26, 1927, when the city of LA signed a 10-year lease on 640 acres of the land to open up LA's first municipal airport.
We got there.
We made it.
It just took a Scottish lord.
A rebel sympathizer.
Canadian. More than a,
yeah. A wealthy Canadian. So the real estate agent who brokered the deal was named William Mines. So they named the new site Mines Field. And they never thought twice about it.
I thought, like, why would you ever call a place where things land a mines field if it's not
a mines field of opportunity?
You never know where you can step in.
Some of that leftover sheep pie.
Could be an active bomb.
Thirsty.
You never know. When opportunity knocks, you step on it. Mines field.
When opportunity knocks, it might explode also. They opened up October 1st, 1928, but they weren't officially dedicated until June 7th, 1930. But in that time, they had formed the city's Department of Airports to run it and built a 2,000-foot oiled runway, which sounds like a bad idea. But
yeah. What
do me and my degree in air control tower know? And they had two 100 feet by 100 feet hangars that could hold up to 40 planes. The first of these hangars was built in June 1929. It was known as Hangar 1 and was designed with a Spanish colonial revival look, as was Hangar 2. But Hangar 1 is actually still there on the southeast corner of LAX, and it's a National Historic Landmark.
Really? Could you visit it?
No.
It's part of LAX.
It is. I mean, you could visit it, but you'll be considered a national terrorist.
Yeah, you'll be on the list.
No, I'm a historian.
What was the third mayor of LA? Oh, I don't remember. I read it once.
Is it a wealthy Canadian?
Is it a member of KKK?
Lucky guess. Yeah, it's there, but I think it's just used for like storage or some company uses it. It can't be visited, though, unless we get a job there. It's the only one of the original buildings of the airport that still stands, and it's in that weird corner because the airport itself used to stretch from what used to be Inglewood Redondo Boulevard, which is now Aviation Boulevard on the east. What used to be 114th Street, but is now Imperial Highway on the south. What used to be Arizona Drive, but is now Sepulveda Boulevard on the west. And what used to be Pine Street, but is now Century Boulevard on the north. So it was a little bit kind of southeast from where it is now.
Okay.
That land is still part of it, but that's where the
was. Oh, it didn't move, it stretched.
Kind of. No, both. Okay. I mean, you'll see.
Okay.
Please. Should stretch your mouth shut.
In the middle of the airport, there's actually a small neighborhood.
It's very exclusive. So like I said, it was officially dedicated on June 7th, 1930, but it also got a new name that day. So it was only Mines Field for a little bit. It was now called the Los Angeles Municipal Airport, and they were open for limited business. 25,000 people came out to the ceremony to watch civilian and military pilots give demonstrations. There were four different bands from the fire department, Santa Monica, the American Legion, and a bugle corps.
Oh yeah, bugle corps.
Then the Goodyear blimp.
That's my favorite type of punk is bugle corps. Go ahead.
The Goodyear blimp landed, and a military lieutenant came out who gave a wreath to a woman who then put the wreath on a propeller in front of the administration building.
Oh, American life is beautiful.
Like I had said in the Burbank one, this airport was not doing commercial business in its early days. It was mostly just commerce and mail and that sort of thing, and also air races. In 1928 alone, they had both the National Air Races and the National Air Carnival, which had 75,000 people coming every day to watch it. Amelia Earhart and Charles Lindbergh were flying out of there. From 1932 to 1936, they even had a racetrack there that was sponsored by Gilmore Oil and drew crowds of also 75,000. That was, you could only congregate in crowds of 75,000. Then in 1937, when their lease was up, the city flat out bought this area. And in 1941, the city passed a $3.5 million bond measure to build up the place, and it was renamed Los Angeles Airport. The idea was to make the place more attractive to passenger airlines and to entice them to fly off their runway and dethrone Burbank as the hub of passenger air travel in Los Angeles.
Okay.
And then World War II hit. World War Infinity War II. Infinity Gauntlet. Before the war, the Los Angeles Airport was designated as an organized reserve aerodrome, but during the actual war, it was used mostly as a military base. That's kind of what it was doing that whole time.
Hold tanks.
There were flying tanks. There were so many military planes there that they had to put camouflage all over it to hide it from any potential weather balloons that were passing by.
Someone's gonna get a heart attack and die.
Don't look at it. The only incident that actually happened there during the war, though, was in October 1944 when a pilot from the Women Air Force Service Pilots named Gertrude Tompkins Silver, she took off from there en route to Palm Springs. So it was LAX to Palm Springs, and she immediately went missing and was never found.
This day?
I mean, what, is she going to show up somewhere?
There's no ocean between us and Palm Springs.
It seems...
have you
check
ever been
your
to
maps.
The Salton Sea?
I think we should dredge the Salton Sea. I think she kind of went, you know, because you kind of go over the ocean when you take off, and I think it was foggy or something, and she just didn't come out of the fog.
Now she's in the Twilight Zone episode where she's like, there's dinosaurs.
Looking for dinosaurs.
Yeah. I always go to, there's so much more to that episode, but I'm always like, there's dinosaurs.
No, it's dinosaur war. Even while all this was happening, a plan was set in motion to position Los Angeles Airport as the airport in town. And once the war was mostly over on May 1st, 1945, the city passed a $12.5 million bond to build new buildings on the northern part of the land. So they were moving away from that original original area.
Oh, I see. Okay.
And turn the old barracks into a cafeteria for future passengers. Same food, though. They had so much left over. Now all they needed was passenger airlines, which they managed to get all at once in a brutal coup against Burbank when they stole American, TWA, Western United, and Southwest from them. And pretty much on the same day, commercial passenger service began on December 9th, 1946. All Burbank was left with was Pan Am. And then in January, they took Pan Am.
That's the game of life.
Yeah.
That's the
played with Clue members. So now this new Los Angeles airport was the passenger and commercial air king of the city, and Burbank had to go back waiting for Bob Hope to die. The next big step was in 1949 when they announced to everybody that they weren't just a place to fly around the country from, they were a place to fly around the world from. So they changed their name to the Los Angeles International Airport, or LAX, as we know it. The reason it's LAX, it's because the standards of the International Air Transport Association, according to them, every airport needs a code name to go by, like GoldenEye. And in the early days, the airport would just use the same codes as the National Weather Service for the cities they were in, and Los Angeles was LA. But as more and more cities got airports, a third letter had to be added to differentiate their code. So some cities added the next letter in their name, and some just added X at the end.
Oh,
and that's what LAX did.
Pretty interesting.
It was a lot less interesting than I thought it was going to be, but you had to know.
I mean, also, like, I never thought of it before.
I just thought X meant airport.
Airport crossing.
That's the shape of their runways. It's very dangerous. The rest of the 40s and 50s were a pretty good time for LAX. They built just watching all the other airports slowly die. They built that Sepulveda Airport underpass that goes under the runway in 1953. Like, it cost $3.5 million, and at the time, that was the only traffic tunnel that went under a major airport's runway in the United States. The first 100 cars to drive through it when they opened got souvenirs from stewardesses at the other end and were then hit by an airplane. I would have loved to have gotten that.
And then they got yelled at for not having their seatbelt on.
No, thank you. Keep your window rolled up. Please, my windshield is plenty clean. Don't.
Please don't. Oh, you started.
They realized real quick that the amount of people using the airport was way more than they were prepared to handle. And this is a theme that is constant for the airport. Not my airport. It was only getting worse and worse every year, and they had to keep moving to keep up with Los Angeles. So to do that, on June 5th, 1956, the city passed a $59 million bond to open up the space and bring LAX into the jet age. So in 1958, they hired the design team of Pereira and Luckman, our old chums designed such hits as CBS Television City, the Disneyland Hotel, and Maryland. Marine Land is what they designed also. Some of their original plans would have been great, and some of them were just very dumb. One early idea was to have a helicopter that would pick up a literal bus from downtown full of passengers and then drop it off at the terminal at LAX.
No.
And that would be a way of getting to the airport. One of them was a sky tram going between all the terminals, which isn't that bad. One had hydraulic underground platforms that would lift passengers to their airplane.
Okay. Like a cherry picker?
No. Like, you would be underground and, like, all right, our flight's boarding. Everyone stand in this area, and then it rises up to where the airport is.
I see. So
the airplane is. Mole people technology.
When we live underground, but we still need to take planes, here's what we're going to do.
We only go above ground for air travel.
Nah.
One plan was to have a center area around everything of reflection pools surrounding a flame lit from Mount Olympus that was carried over by Greece.
Okay. Gary read a book about ancient Greece, and now all his ideas sort of just revolve around, I don't know, fire and statues.
How about if we have this one in the shape of Zeus? I don't know. The grandest idea, it came up in a theory exercise in one of Pereira's architecture classes at USC. It was to have the entire place be a giant glass dome that would serve as one huge terminal with six unconnected satellite terminals surrounding it where the planes would park that you would access from the dome via either underground tunnels or elevated walkways. So it's basically like a biodome with little like moons around it, and that's where the planes would park.
Like a little beehive.
I don't think you've seen a beehive before.
But you have seen biodome.
People may not be familiar with beehives, but we all know what the biodome looks like, correct?
We all know that Pauly Shore was in a film called Biodome, so I think we all know what's going on.
By the way, that's where comedy is moving, is Pauly Shore's new comedy.
It's a biodome.
So the glass dome itself would have been filled with banana and palm trees and held up by a giant central pillar with a map of the world on it. And on top of that would have been a restaurant. It didn't happen for three reasons. Because it's crazy. Because the air conditioning costs would have been astronomical. And because the airlines wanted their own terminals and they didn't want to share. So what they came up with was basically what we have today, which is they turned the old main roadway of the place into a loop for heavy, quote, quote unquote easy entry and exit and have the terminals positioned along it in what some call the world's largest cul-de-sac. That's what it's shaped like now. It's a U-shaped thing, and then along the skin of that U is where the terminals are. So it's not the prettiest thing, but I guess it seemed like a good idea at the time. But it did make the airport accessible to the new airplane technology. And on January 25th, 1959, the first commercial jet engine airplane landed at LAX. The official three-day opening ceremony happened in June 1961 with Vice President LBJ giving a speech on June 25th to a crowd of 100,000 people who were all just waiting to get to their check-in for the bags. Move! Why is he still talking? So like I said, the airport was now this cul-de-sac with 172-foot control tower, and then around it were seven terminals that opened up between 1961 and 62. These were terminals 2 through 8. So 2 was used for international flights, but terminal 1 wouldn't open up until 2 decades later, which we'll get to. They still kept the idea of detached satellite gates. So each terminal was connected to the gate. What's on the road are the terminals. Yeah. And then the gate is where the plane parks.
Right.
So they had the U-shaped road mm-hmm. and then a U-shaped terminals around it.
Yeah.
And then satellite detached from that were the gates where the planes were parked. So you'd go in the gate, you would go through underground tunnels, and then from the gate, you no longer, this was also a new thing, you no longer had to walk onto the tarmac to board a plane. Now you could go in those extendable tunnels directly from the gate. You didn't have to sully your shoes on the tarmac, that oiled tarmac.
I call that the throat.
You go through the gizzard of the airplane. So these satellite gates were also connected with each other by separate underground tunnels. So because of this huge network of underground tunnels, LAX became one of the first airports in the world to put in moving walkways, or as they were called, astroways, to get people moving along quicker. And the first passenger to use them at LAX, Lucille Ball.
Get out of town.
She was the first one.
Today is her death anniversary.
Is it?
Yeah.
Huh. Well, she had a good life. She had a good life. She got to ride on an astroway.
The first person who got to. This escalator sucks.
Make it flat. Man, Ricky. Ricky, make me flat. But they also wanted the tunnels to not look like the post-apocalypse world that the rest of LA looked like at the time. So they got an interior designer named Charles D. Krotka to beautify them. Although there's a lot of proof that this was actually done by a woman who worked for Pereira and Luckman named Janet Bennett. There's evidence that it was made by her and they just never gave her credit. But regardless of who did it, they put up mosaics along the long walls of 7 of the tunnels that have been in lots of things like Jackie Brown and Mad Men and think in The Graduate. Only 3 of these are still open to the public in terminals 3, 4, and 6. So the most artistic thing to come out of all these renovations at this time is something we've kind of talked about before, the theme building.
Yeah.
The big boy. It was made by a super group of Pereira and Luckman and associates, Welton Beckett and associates, and our old friend Paul R. Williams playing himself in Pee Wee Herman's Big Adventure. Little Paulie Williams. But the design itself was made by an architect named Jin Wong. It cost $2.2 million and was completed in 1960 on the location that the giant dome that they were almost going to make was supposed to be in. And a lot of people thought it was the airport's control tower, including me as a kid. But in reality, it was just a revolving restaurant with a 360-degree observation deck on top. More importantly, it was the Googie masterpiece in a city that they know Googie. It also inspired the look of the building in the Jetsons. It is a very influential building.
Yeah, and that's
how we see the future. But even by the time all these renovations were done, they almost immediately had to do more to keep up with the demand the city was putting on it. So traffic was a major problem. They started building more parking garages and satellite lots with shuttle buses. They even redesigned the entire intersection of Sepulveda and Century just to try to improve the flow. But in the 70s, they came up with the perfect solution. LA was too crowded. Obvious solution. Build an island 5 miles off the coast with a full runway to lighten the load. It'll be a bigger satellite from LAX off the coast.
Off the coast.
So it was going to be called the Seadrome and would connect to the mainland by hydrofoils and helicopters, or maybe just connected to the 10 freeway or a subway tunnel to Marina Del Rey. But it wouldn't just have an extra airport. It would have apartments, beaches, a sports center, a convention center. Obviously, this plan was...
It's a new town with no traffic. No one has cars.
And we can keep building west. The city doesn't have to stop at the ocean.
We'll just fish to survive.
Obviously, it was a huge success. And Terminal Island, but terminal-like airport terminal, is still out there. Yeah. We all know it. So it wasn't until a full decade after that and the Olympics announcing that they were coming to town that not dumb improvements started. First of all, they finished that Terminal 1 that I mentioned before that never got completed. But now, to accommodate all international visitors coming to town for the Olympics, they made a whole new mega terminal right in the prime spot at the hardest part to get in the whole cul-de-sac. Construction began in 1981, and on June 11th, 1984, the Tom Bradley International Terminal was open for business.
Named after the mayor.
Named after who?
Mayor.
mayor. So this covered all international flights and lightened the load a little on the other 8 terminals. But in terms of traffic, they also made the entire airport 2 stories, as it now is today, with a double-layered road leading you in and out of the airport. So departures on the upper level, arrivals on the lower level. Obviously, the airport had to stay open while all this was going on. So for 3 years, traffic was driving underneath the whole other layer of airport being built on top of them. So they also added 3 new parking garages. These renovations also marked the end of most of the underground tunnels that ran through the place. Bummer. They added above ground connectors linking the check-in terminals to the gates, which is why it all looks like a horseshoe with piers jutting out of it now. Many were sealed off. Some are still used for storage. After 9/11, they sealed off the tunnels connecting the terminals to each other, so you'd have to go outside and then back in through security if you wanted to reach a different terminal. But in 2014, they reopened those tunnels for terminals 4, 5, and 6, and they also used some of them for arriving passengers and when it gets too crowded during the busy season. So some of them are kind of still being used. It's impossible to map this place. Like, I had to keep looking at different maps to try to figure out, like, what year is this and what how are people getting around? But I'm really smart, so it wasn't so hard for me.
But I have a very organized brain, so it, you know, I mostly do calculations all day.
The 90s to the late 2000s, things kind of stayed the same. In 1996, they added a new 277-foot control tower and turned the old one into offices. In January 1997, the Encounter restaurant opened in the theme building with an interior designed by Walt Disney Imagineering, which I didn't know.
It's a payback.
It was a slow death for this restaurant, though. On September 11th, they closed the observation deck until 2010, and then on February 24th, 2007, a half-ton piece of stucco fell off the building onto the roof of the restaurant, which prompted a 3-year, $14.3 million renovation. But in 2014, they closed the restaurant for good.
Stucco piece still there, though.
I couldn't figure out how to get it off. LAX's newest iconic feature came in the year 2000 as the giant light pylons guiding you in and out of the main roadway.
Oh, right.
It was designed by Ted Tokyo Tanaka Architects.
Love it.
Ted Tokyo Tanaka toots his tin tunier and is romantically titled Untitled.
Nice boys.
The light effects were done by a guy named Paul Xanatopoulos, and they're meant to remind you of ancient pillars from old Greek temples, old city towers, Stonehenge, while also showcasing bright local colors. So when you enter the airport, they go up like a plane taking off. When you're driving away, they go down like a plane landing. Tallest one is 100 feet, and in 2006 they switched to LED lights.
Thanks.
Thanks, Ted. But again, the airport had to grow to keep up with the city. God. In February 2007, a $4.1 billion makeover of the airport began, which was the biggest public project in Los Angeles history. $1.6 billion of that alone went into redoing the Tom Bradley Terminal. And by the time it reopened in September 2013, it had a completely new interior that was double the size and designed by the same occultist who did the Denver airport. The shape of it is modeled after the Pacific Ocean. It has the Villaraigosa Pavilion with over 60 shops and restaurants, many of them like local things, local restaurants like local things like California Pizza Kitchen and Sbarro. They added a new boarding gate for bigger, more modern airplanes. There's also the Time Tower. It's this huge pillar of LED screens that can work together to form any design or image that they want. And it's the biggest interactive display in the world. But the history of LAX hasn't been all air shows and traffic jams.
I don't believe it.
There have been actual bad things that have happened here over the years.
Well, you know that I need to hear those kind of things.
They caught the Golden State Killer. Plenty of planes have crashed into the ocean right after takeoff. There have been a few mid-air collisions on the runway and the surrounding area. Continental Airlines had their headquarters at LAX from 1963 to 83, and during that time, the CEO of their company killed himself in his office at LAX.
Okay.
On August 6, 1974, a bomb went off near the Pan Am counter in Terminal 2. Jeez. 3 people were killed and 36 were injured. The man arrested for it was Muharrem Kurbegovic, the so-called alphabet bomber. Have you ever heard of him?
I remember hearing about that, yeah.
His plan was to detonate bombs around LA in locations whose first letters would spell out the name of his group, Aliens of America. The first location being A for airport. He was caught before his second bomb could go off, which was in a locker in a Greyhound bus station, L for locker. When the bomb squad defused it, they said it was the most powerful bomb they had ever seen.
Wow.
In a Greyhound station where I go to pick up my drugs.
I mean, you're so certain that people are going to be like, locker, I know. L for locker, like, why not G for Greyhound?
I know, it didn't make any even the A for airport. I was like, well, it was kind of in the terminal. if you want to get specific, is it P for Pan Am? In 1987, a former PSA Airlines employee went onto a flight from LAX to San Francisco with a handgun in his bag. Halfway through the flight, he went into the cockpit with the gun, killed the pilots, and crashed the plane, killing all 43 people on board.
Awful.
On December 14th, 1999, the Millennium bomber, Ahmed Rassam, was caught in Washington with a car filled with 100 pounds of explosive meant to go off at LAX on New Year's Eve on behalf of Al-Qaeda.
Happy New Year.
In 2002, a man who hated Israel shot up the El Al counter, killing 2 and injuring 4 before he himself was killed by Israeli security. In 2013, a guy shot his way through the TSA in Terminal 3 with an assault rifle and then got into a shootout with security.
I remember that.
Yeah, nobody was killed, but a lot of injuries. Also in 2013, some people set off a dry ice bomb in Terminal 2. Then in 2014, some 14 baggage handlers were arrested in Terminal 4 and the Tom Bradley Terminal for running an elaborate baggage theft ring that stole thousands of dollars worth of stuff from people's bags, which is, in my opinion, the greatest tragedy.
My shampoo!
I was planning to bring back those macadamia nuts for my grandma. Today, LAX is run by Los Angeles World Airports, who also runs the Van Nuys Airport. It covers 3,425 acres of land. It has 4 runways running east to west, 25,000 parking spots, including valet parking at Terminal 4. According to them, there's 75 passenger airlines flying out of there, but I only counted 60. So
there's that's what Dan does calculate. I smell inaccuracies.
There's 27 cargo only airlines that fly out of there. There's now 9 terminals with spots for about 140 planes at any one time. It's the base of the U.S. Coast Guard in L.A. They control oil pollution and enforce maritime law from there. The theme building now houses a USO center, which sounds suspiciously like UFO in my opinion.
Yeah, is it full of weather balloons?
Don't open those doors. The observation deck is actually open, which I didn't know, 8 to 5 on weekends for free. Since 2003, there's been an official song of LAX called LA International Airport by David Frizzell, made popular by Susan Ray in 1970. It's actually a pretty catchy song, if not dumb.
But how many songs do we listen to that are dumb but catchy?
Since it's a base of most flights towards the east, it is referred to as the gateway to the Pacific Rim to Infinity War Gauntlet.
Infinity War Gauntlet.
It generates around $60 billion a year in commerce and employs about 408,000 people across all of Southern California, which means that 1 in all 20 jobs in Southern California are related to the operations of LAX.
That's crazy. Even thinking insane. Right now, I think I know 3 people who work at LAX.
Yeah, it's, well, not just, there's so many people at LAX and then people like, oh, we do this offsite for LAX.
Yeah, exactly.
This
gets,
in 2017, over 1.8 million tons of freight and mail passed through LAX. Damn. And also 84.6 million passengers, which is almost a third of the entire country.
That's crazy.
Which is why LAX is the 5th busiest airport in the entire world. But it's not enough. It's still not enough. If you've ever been to LAX, you know that it's a horrific crowd at all times.
Yeah.
And we've got an Olympics coming in 10 years. So stuff is already in the works to try to fix these problems and trick the world into thinking we've got a smoothly running airport. In February 2017, they started a $1.6 billion makeover of the whole place. Among the updates, there's going to be a consolidated car rental facility where all of them are. A new above ground connectors between the terminals. So between these and the underground tunnels that they're still using, if you were to check in at Terminal 1, you'd be able to walk all the way around to Terminal 8 without having to go through security again, which will make it easier to get to your connecting flight. And also, just take the tour, man. It's worth the price
of
admission.
See the sights. Yeah, now that you know all this information, boy, you loaded with history.
Ooh, Sbarro.
Nah, the third thing, they're going to bring that dome back.
We like the dome idea, but we still want to have separate terminals. So we're going to put the dome on top of everything. And then to take care of the air conditioning problem, no air conditioning.
We've got it. What we had before, it was sort of like a snow globe. So it's going to be a big bowl now. We're going to turn the dome upside down.
It will be so big, though, that it will create its own atmosphere and it may snow. As part of all this, they did this massive reshuffling of the terminals in May of 2017. It started on May 12th. And over the course of the next 5 days, they moved 20 airlines to different terminals. That includes office supplies, equipment, signs, furniture, airplanes, service vehicles, everything they owned while the airport was still open.
Imagine getting there and while you loaded into a United flight, it changes terminals. You're in the wrong place. Don't you see the signs?
You're on the wrong flight and no refunds also.
It's like you're going to Hawaii.
It took a year to plan this without having to shut down the entire airport, and there were over 200 volunteers directing people like, where my flight's in 10 minutes, where and I'm supposed to be in this terminal. Delta alone took 3 days to move. This was the biggest relocation in U.S. aviation history. Oh, this was our Dunkirk.
I don't get that.
It's British for fanny.
It's British for moving.
So this relocation not only gave some of the bigger airlines more space, so it won't be as crowded, it also made the distribution of the big airlines more even throughout the airport, so it's not just a huge pileup of cars dropping people off on one side of the airport. This means less flights will be delayed because now there will be fewer of the big airlines sharing the same runways So the two biggest changes, however, will be an entirely new satellite terminal called the Midfield Satellite that's west of Tom Bradley. It's going to be 5 stories high, and it'll be connected to Tom Bradley by one of those classic underground tunnels with a moving walkway. It's going to have 12 new gates that can accommodate huge new airplanes and lots of new shops and restaurants. That's going to open in 2019. The second big thing happened, I thought I was done with all my research, and then this was announced, a $4.9 billion 2.25 mile long people mover connecting from the Future Green Line and Crenshaw LAX light rail to the airport, which are three things that don't exist yet.
Yeah.
It's going to run every 2 minutes and it'll set to open in 2023, but in my opinion, it's going to be helpful for people coming to see the Olympics at the main stadiums, but this is not going to help most people going to the airport.
No, my proposal is that there's a helicopter that picks up a bus.
How about a helicopter that picks up an airplane and drops you off?